Hello, very warm welcome to everyone. I am Jet Aguilar from the Astronomical League of the Philippines, and I will be your host for today's ALP opening program for the 2023 National Astronomy Week celebration. Thank you so much again for joining us on this beautiful Sunday morning. We are very fortunate that we have with us today some very prominent and esteemed speakers gracing our National Astronomy Week opening program. For those who were not able to register but will still want to watch this webinar, we are currently live streaming on Facebook, on the Facebook page of Philippine Astronomy Forum. So you can join us there as well. Before we start, kindly allow me to explain some rules for this webinar to help us make this an enjoyable learning experience for everyone. Please listen and do your best to give your undivided attention to our speakers. There will be a short question and answer session at the end of each lecture. You may type in your questions under the Q&A tab found in your Zoom interface at any point during the presentation. We'll do our best to read and answer your questions live after the lecture or via the Q&A tab. We would like to remind everyone that the contents presented in this webinar will remain as the individual property of the lecturer and the photographers in the presentation. We will also be distributing certificates of attendance via email to all registered attendees who will be present with us throughout the webinar. So please use the name you have written in your registration forms to help us facilitate this process. Let us all enjoy this talk and have fun learning. Here's the program flow for the opening program today. I would like to turn you over now to Mr. James Kevin T, the President of the Astronomical League of the Philippines, to give his welcome remarks.
Thank you, Jet, for the introduction. Greetings to all. I would like to welcome all our attendees and distinguished guest speakers as the Astronomical League of the Philippines celebrates the opening of the National Astronomy Week 2023. It has been 30 years since the presidential proclamation that started the annual observance of the National Astronomy Week on every third week of February, and 33 years since the observance of the first National Astronomy Week in the Philippines. It is my goal, it's my great honor to welcome Ms. Imelda Joson, who with Edwin Aguirre, initiated the first National Astronomy Week in 1990. She will be introducing our esteemed speakers, Dr. Debra M, who will be giving us our opening remarks. Edwin and Imelda.
Actually, I'm going to do the introduction in behalf of Imelda. So thank you very much, James, and welcome everybody to the opening program of the National Astronomy Week. And it is my great and distinct honor to introduce to you today no other than Dr. Debra Elmegreen to give some welcome remarks for our program. I just want to give some brief background about Dr. Elmegreen. She was the professor of astronomy on the Mariah Mitchell Chair at Vassar College in New York. And she is a well-known and well-respected researcher of the structure and evolution of galaxies at optical, infrared, and radio wavelengths. She has used a variety of land-based and space telescopes, including the Hubble Space Telescope and now the James Webb Space Telescope. Dr. Elmegreen is president of the International Astronomical Union, IAU, the first American female to hold this position in the organization's 103-year history. And she is also the past president of the American Astronomical Society. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Elmegreen for the welcome remarks.
Thank you for your kind introduction, Edwin. I'm delighted to welcome you all to the 32nd Philippine National Astronomy Week. Congratulations on this long-running celebration, which, as you've heard and seen in the beautiful video, was first proposed by Imelda and Edwin to then-President Aquino in 1990. You'll be hearing more from them shortly. Their draft resolution became the official proclamation that the president signed into law, and the opening ceremony was attended by the Secretary of the Department of Science and Technology. In 1992, then-Vice President Laurel attended the second celebration. In 1993, as you heard from President Tai, President Ramos officially declared the third Sunday of February every year as the start of National Astronomy Week. The International Astronomical Union mirrors the spirit of National Astronomy Week in a global context and shares many of the same goals as the Astronomical League of the Philippines. The IAU is the worldwide organization of professional astronomers. Our mission is to promote and safeguard astronomy in all its aspects, including research, communication, education, and development through international cooperation. Founded in 1919, the IAU has 12,000 individual and junior members from 85 countries, including the Philippines. Astronomy is deeply rooted in our histories and cultures, forging bonds across society. The universe, as a time machine, allows us to reconstruct our cosmic history, viewing distant galaxies as they appeared when they were younger, and inviting broad thoughts about our place on fragile Earth. Astronomical technology also provides serendipitous benefits to society, such as the use of GPS in our cell phones. With the launch of the James Webb Space Telescope and other successful missions, public interest in cosmology, exoplanets, the Milky Way, and other galaxies is high. The IAU taps into that interest, using astronomy as a tool to help achieve UN Sustainable Development Goals, including those on partnerships, education, gender and minority inequalities, infrastructure, sustainable communities, clean energy, climate action, and peace. Astronomers use many skills that are transferable to other fields, such as computer programming and statistics applied to large data sets in climate science, medicine, finance. Our Office of Astronomy for Development has engaged hundreds of thousands of people in projects that draw on the excitement of astronomy and apply its technologies to development in communities. Our astrotourism program brings visitors to remote sites, such as the Himalayas, to see dark skies with local guides. Astronomy, of course, inspires curiosity. Our Office of Astronomy for Education aids science teacher development in using astronomy as a gateway to STEM fields for school children. This will lead to a generation better able to tackle global science problems. Our Office for Young Astronomers hosts regional astrophysics summer schools, and hands-on workshops provide training for early career astronomers in developing countries to foster their research programs. Our regional and international symposia bring astronomers together to share their research and discoveries. It's vital that we engage a diverse global community in science, since that will broaden ideas and perspectives. To that end, our Office for Astronomy Outreach has coordinators around the globe, including in the Philippines. Its projects in over 100 countries involve translating astronomy into native languages, encouraging girls in science through activities with women mentors, and providing school children with telescopes. Our diplomacy efforts bring together children in post-conflict regions through their enjoyment of astronomy. We strive for an inclusive astronomical community through activities such as Inspiring Stars, which is a traveling international exhibit for the visually impaired that uses tactile models and sound to represent astronomical objects. Another program translates astronomical terms into sign language for the hearing impaired. As fundamental as astronomy is to humanity, the field would never have developed without our ability to see the night sky. Yet many people today have never had a clear view of the Milky Way. We'll be hearing more about this in the next talk. Our working group on dark and quiet skies aims to minimize light pollution so we can continue to enjoy space and so wildlife natural rhythms are not disrupted. Our outreach programs also inform the public about climate change through astronomer studies of the evolution of atmospheres on the Earth and other planets. Astronomers rely on observations that cover the electromagnetic spectrum and detect cosmic messengers such as gravitational waves, cosmic rays, and neutrinos. Space-based platforms are critical for ultraviolet and infrared wavelengths that can be detected only above the atmosphere. Ground-based observatories allow big optical telescopes and radio arrays. Our working group on global coordination of ground and space astrophysics draws on our collective expertise to tackle international multi-wavelength endeavors. Unfortunately, both optical and radio observations from the ground are threatened by the enormous number of new communication satellites crossing our skies. While they serve an important purpose in connecting us, they also reflect sunlight and transmit data at radio wavelengths. Our Center for the Protection of Dark and Quiet Skies is working with the United Nations, companies, and other organizations to help mitigate the impact of satellite constellations on our views of space. We all share the same sky, and like all of you, the IAU strives for a better understanding, appreciation, and stewardship of it. I wish you all a wonderful Astronomy Week. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Debra. That was a great welcome talk. Can we ask now Imelda to give the introduction for our speaker?
I'll be doing the honors to of introducing Kelly. Kelly Beatty of Sky and Telescope. We've known him for many years, and we had the pleasure and the privilege of working with him at Sky and Telescope for 12 years. Kelly was there much, much longer than us. So Kelly is the senior editor of Sky and Telescope. He joined the staff in 1974 and also served as editor of Night Sky, the magazine for beginning stargazers from 2004 to 2007. So after 43 years of pounding his keyboard, Kelly retired from full-time work in early 2018. But he remains actively involved in the many activities of the magazines, including tours for chasing solar eclipses. So he's a veteran solar eclipse chaser. Now, Kelly specializes in planetary science and space exploration. And he conceived and edited the New Solar System, which is considered a standard reference among planetary scientists. And he is also a well-known educator of astronomy. And he has been honored by the American Astronomical Society's Division of Planetary Sciences with many awards, including the Harold Mazursky Award in 2005 and the Jonathan Eberhardt Journalism Award in 2009, and recently the American Geophysical Union's Cohen Award for Sustained Achievement in Science Journalism. Now, Kelly hails from Madera, California, and holds a bachelor's degree in geology from the California Institute of Technology, and a master's degree in science journalism from Boston University. In 1983, asteroid 2925 Beatty was named by the IAU in honor of Kelly and his marriage to Cheryl. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a very warm welcome to our guest speaker for tonight, Kelly Beatty of Sky and Telescope, who will be talking about darkness in distress.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Edwin and Imelda. Edwin, we're going to have to get together and edit that introduction down. We didn't leave any time for the talk, so we'll just take questions at this point, I guess. No.
We can skip to the Q&A.
We'll fast forward to that. Hey, I am deeply thrilled and so honored that you asked me to come and make this presentation for your annual National Astronomy Week. I know it's been going for more than 30 years now. It's quite a long and enduring part of the fabric of astronomical outreach and just participation there in the Philippines. And I'm really thrilled to be here tonight. As Edwin mentioned, I've known him and Imelda for, close to 30 years now. They must have skipped out of the Philippines and headed the Sky and Telescope right after establishing the Astronomy Week, I think. So tonight we're going to talk about a problem and maybe some solutions to light pollution, something that has been growing ever more of a problem, I'm sure in the Philippines, certainly here in the United States. So let me just call up the talk and get it started. Slideshow from the beginning. I hope you can see that okay. If you can't, well, too bad. So let's start with a quote. And this is a sort of sets the stage for what we're going to be seeing and talking about. With lights and ever more lights. Let's see if I can get this to advance better. There we go. We drive the holiness and beauty of the night back to the forest and the sea. Now, this is a feeling, an expression of disgust with night light pollution that could have been written last week. But in fact, it was written almost a century ago by a writer who spent a year on Cape Cod, which here in the United States is a fairly dark place. So we're going to talk about what we've lost and how we can maybe get it back. But first, let's talk about what light pollution is. You know, I think you know it when you see it. It's artificial illumination of the night in all of its forms. Now, we think of light pollution generally as that, but we can kind of subdivide it into things like glare from a harsh light, trespass from one property to another, disturbance of the natural nocturnal ecosystem and landscape. Basically, you know, a lot of the light that we generate at night does not hit the ground, what we call the task area. Instead, it goes up into the sky, and that's where we have a problem. So I'm going to show you a light here that's here in Chelmsford, Massachusetts, where I live. This is very common in the United States. In older communities, established communities, they want to reinstall this kind of antique-looking period lighting, we call it, to hark back to a time when, you know, horses were on the main street and so forth. But I want to call your attention. I think you can see my cursor to this light bulb, which is right here, hanging up in the middle of the light. Well, when that gets turned on at night, it creates light in all directions, up, to the side, down. And that's a really good example of all that can be bad with an outdoor light. But I'm using that as an example to kind of give you a framework for how we who get involved in fighting light pollution and need to frame the problem. Any light that's emitted above horizontal is called uplight. The light that goes down onto where you're trying to get it, the task area, is useful. And then there's this slice just below horizontal, which creates a lot of glare and a lot of problems for people. So those are the three. And, you know, we've all seen, and I will show you a little bit later, images of the Earth taken from space at night. And that you see this, you know, this blanket of lights from cities around the globe. And that is light that is headed straight up toward the zenith in the night sky. And you might think that that is the worst possible kind of light pollution, but actually it's not. This is a computer simulation that shows how much sky glow is created, how much scatter is created in the atmosphere by beams of light emitted at different angles. So the top panel there is a narrow cone of light that's heading basically straight up. And you can see that the amount of scatter is relatively limited. And if you think about it, that makes sense because our atmosphere is very thin. And once those photons exit the atmosphere, they can't create any more scatter. The lower two panels show what happens when that beam gets closer and closer to horizontal. And the one at the bottom is just above horizontal, within 10 degrees above horizontal. And this creates scatter for tens of miles, tens of kilometers in the sky, far away from the pattern. I live about I live probably around 40 kilometers from downtown Boston. And when I look straight up in my sky, which is pretty dark as suburbs go, but when I look straight up, part of the light pollution, part of the sky glow that I have to deal with is created by lights 40 kilometers away in Boston that are sent almost above, just above horizontal, like that bottom panel shows. So here are some of the most wanted lists in this war against light pollution. We don't have as many of these now as we used to, but and maybe I have no idea what the lighting situation is in Philippines, but for many, many years, street lights were used this kind of shape. It's kind of like a glass salad bowl underneath a metal housing. The glass was actually a lens that refracted the light, and the light bulb itself was below horizontal, so that a lot of the light went down, but some of it still went up to the side. A later design created a flat bottom, and the light was actually tucked up inside here. And that was better because it at least forced all of the light to come out and below horizontal. By the way, again, I'm not sure what your situation is in the Philippines, but here in the US, all of these, all streetlights have a little sensor, a shaped like a small cylinder on top, which senses twilight in the evening and dawn approaching in the morning and causes the light to turn on and off automatically. This is one of the worst kinds of fixtures from the standpoint of light pollution. It's what we call a wall pack. It would be the kind of fixture that a business would slap above a doorway, both to illuminate the doorway and maybe to illuminate the parking lot beyond. It's a horrible kind of fixture. And this is the kind of, as seen from the side, this is the kind of beam spread that you get up and out and down, but a lot of it goes into the sky. And I call your attention to this particular fixture because the business that has this should know better. It's the Regional Research Office for the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency here in Chelmsford. It's just not a good example to be set. This is another really bad kind of lighting here in the Northeast U.S. If you're a business and you don't want to expend the money to create your own parking lot lighting, you can ask the utility to put lights on the poles that run along the street. And that's very economical from the business point of view because you don't actually have to pay for these things. The utility puts them up and then turns them on. And they are just awful with a capital A in terms of light spread. And for those of you who might be interested in trying to take some pictures of really bad light fixtures at night, I suggest that you wait until it's a foggy night like this was, because then you get to see all those, the beam spread really, really easily. Now, one of the growing areas of concern, at least here in the US, is sports lighting. And this is an interesting example here. This is the United States Tennis Association a national facility outside of New York City. And on the right here, you see some older style lights and you can see the horrible glare and you can imagine how bad these are for the nighttime sky. On the left are modern, very well shielded fixtures created by a company called Musco, which is leading the industry in terms of creating dark sky friendly lighting. All of those light fixtures are on. You almost can't tell that they're on because the shielding is so good. So let's tick through the five things that light pollution does to really create problems all around our world. The first, and the one you're probably most familiar with, is the loss of the starry sky. Now, here in the US, about 20 years ago, we had a really widespread blackout in the Northeast. And major whole chunks of southern Canada and the Northeast went black. You can see here what would be Detroit and Cleveland, Columbus, those are all dark. Toronto's dark, Ottawa's dark. Here in Boston, it's unchanged. So an amateur astronomer living in Toronto took advantage of this blackout. This took place in August, so the Milky Way was high in the sky, to take a photo of the beautiful Milky Way as seen over downtown Toronto during the blackout. These lights down here in the bottom are candle lights in his house. The next night, the lights came back on. He retook the photo, and this is what he got. And this is, I'm sure, a familiar scene for all of you. but it demonstrates pretty graphically what we have lost to sky glow in our modern society, how many of the stars we just can't see. Now, here in the US, the National Park Service has undertaken a multi-decade process to try to characterize the quality of the night sky over its parks, with the understanding and the realization that the nighttime environment is important too. So they had a team of amateur astronomers go around the country. This was in one of our darkest national parks in Utah. You can see the map here where it is. Yeah, this is a light pollution map down here in the lower corner, left corner, and you can see that's just black where this is. And in fact, this is a pretty dark sky. So the circle is a fisheye photo, an all sky photo. And then this is a panorama at the top going all the way around the horizon. There are a couple of small light domes from towns in the distance, but most of the light you see here is from the Milky Way. And so that's great. That's what you want. You want your prominent light sources to be the stars themselves. Now compare that with this same technique, color-coded for intensity, taken from the Mojave Desert in Southern California. And toward the east, toward the northeast, is this huge light dome on the horizon from Las Vegas. Now, these color-coded maps were actually derived from actual photos. Here's one of those photos taken by the team. And you see this sort of artifact in the sky, this streak. That is not an artifact. That is real. That is a searchlight pointing up into the sky from the top of one of the casinos in downtown Las Vegas. And here we are about 50 kilometers away, and it's still very obvious in the sky to the camera. A little bit closer to where I am, and this is a kind of a battle zone, if you will, is a park called Acadia National Park. It's actually an island as part of Maine. And the sky is pretty dark generally. It's the same scheme. Here on the horizon is a little blip from a town called Bar Harbor, which is the largest town. This area is trying to get certification as a dark sky place, a dark sky park. And so Bar Harbor and the other towns have gotten together, and they're trying to improve their lighting, enact ordinances and regulations that will beat down the light pollution, because this is an area that a lot of astronomers go to. A little bit closer to the West Coast, some of the parks have already undergone major overhauls of their lighting in an attempt to make their nocturnal environment as good as it possibly can be. In Yosemite National Park, they brought in lighting designers, so you'll see a lot of very low-level amber lighting that is not disruptive to the nighttime environment, but still allows people to see and move about. It's also happening has happened in the Grand Canyon National Park, for example. So I'll say this a few times, the International Dark Sky Association, which is sort of the champion in the fight against light pollution, has created this certification program for places that have done the right thing. They're either naturally dark or they are trying to get dark. And you can see there are different categories here. And some of them are in the Rocky Mountains of the US, which is pretty dark generally. But some of them, you see a few here, there are places like in suburban Chicago here and in Southern Florida. So this is a growing program. It's a quite rigorous process to get certified by the IDA, and that's a program that's ongoing. So number two is what we lose visually when we encounter light pollution at night. There's go through a little physiology here. You know, our eyes see using two different systems of sensors in our retina. During the day, we use what are called cones. That's what gives us our color vision. Cones respond to a lot of light and show us what color is. And I want you to notice that the peak of their sensitivity is sort of in the green, yellow part of the spectrum. Then when it gets dark at night, the cones stop functioning. There's not enough light to trigger a color response. And our rods take over, what we think of as our night vision. When we get dark adapted at night, it's the rods that are doing that work for us. And they are much more sensitive to light. This is a log scale here on the y-axis. And so rods are 1,000 times more sensitive than the cones are. But two things about that. First of all, their peak sensitivity is in the blue-green part of the spectrum. And the second thing is that rods are not a color system. So we can see well at night, but we only see shades of gray. Now, where that becomes important is when we try to get dark adapted, you know, our eyes work pretty well at night. We can see in pretty dim light. We all have experienced walking around at night with just by the light of a full moon. It's easy to do. When we get a strong source of glare like this security light in our field of view at night, the rods and our eyes react badly to that. Our pupils contract and let less light in, so we can see, we can't see in the dark corners as much, and whatever dark adaptation we've accumulated gets wiped out. And so when you have a source of glare like this, you miss some obvious things. Like in this case, you miss the guy standing in the open doorway. So, you know, one of the things that we in the IDA are trying to do is to get rid of glare. Yes, we're trying to get rid of light pollution, but glare is one of those symptoms that is very obvious to everyone. It becomes especially a problem for older citizens because our eyes, you know, start to fail us. They get cloudy, we get cataracts. And the same blue light that creates blue sky during the day creates all the scatter, most of the sky glow at night. It's a process called Rayleigh scattering, and I won't get into it too much, but suffice it to say that blue light creates more scatter, creates more harsh conditions for our eyes, is more disruptive to the nighttime environment. And as you'll see, it is sort of the bad guy, if you will, in this light pollution game. Let's talk about those environmental consequences. Do you realize that 70% of all creatures, lizards, amphibians, you know, higher order creatures, insects, are nocturnal at some level? They do something at night. A lot of species only do stuff at night. They migrate, they mate, they eat. And so light pollution is very disruptive. Here in New England, nothing is more symptomatic of that problem than the problem we are having keeping our fireflies around. Fireflies, do you have fireflies in the Philippines? Yes? Okay, well, here fireflies yes. come out right at dusk, and the males are showing off, as happens with many species, trying to attract the females. And the problem is that if there's a lot of light pollution around, they are not as obvious. And in fact, studies have shown that with a lot of ambient light pollution, the females don't even show up. The males can be out there flashing their little tails off, and the females are just not around. So that's not very good for the future of fireflies. The other thing that you might not realize is that there are a whole class of insects that are nocturnal pollinators. They are the ones going from flower to flower, but at night. Moths especially are nocturnal pollinators. And the presence of outdoor lighting causes them to just not be as active. Less pollination takes place. So pollination is really bad in the presence of light pollution. And more broadly, you might have heard of this term insect apocalypse. If you haven't, go look it up. It's a real thing. The worldwide population of insects has declined by 75% in the last 50 years. That's a staggering number. Now, there are a lot of reasons for that, but a major reason is light pollution. And in particular, I'm sure you've all noticed that insects at night are attracted to bright lights. When that happens, up to a third of them are dead before morning from just through having been attracted to that light at night. I could go on. Birds, the migration of birds is affected by light pollution because they use stars in their navigation when they're migrating. This is a map of the United States and the major migration routes that birds take. And little known fact, songbirds in particular migrate at an altitude of 100 meters or less. And so they are very susceptible to the presence of lit buildings, skyscrapers in their path. And when that happens, rather than traveling in a straight line like on the left, following just, for example, moonlight as a guide, when they see a bright building, they go, they like, if they want to keep it off their left wing, for example, they'll move in a circle around it. And eventually they are just exhausted and they drop from the sky either dead or exhausted. It makes them easy prey. And here in the United States alone, more than 600 bird deaths annually are attributed to collisions with buildings during migration season and at other times because those buildings are lit at night. It's a staggering toll that is taken on our birds. One last example I'm going to give you is sea turtle hatchlings, most prominent in tropical climates. The sea turtles climb out, they plant their eggs, bury their eggs in the sand on the beach. The hatchlings, once they come out of their shells, are trying to desperately to get to the water as quickly as they can, which is easy to do if there's no lights around because they see glints off the waves, and so they know to go there. But if there's development or buildings in the way, they go in the wrong direction, sometimes crossing road, and they become easy roadkill. Sorry for the gross photo, but that's just what happens, especially here down in Florida. Number four is human consequences, which is an emerging area of research. When you are awake during the daytime, the amount of a compound called melatonin in your bloodstream is very low. Melatonin is an amazing compound. It has all sorts of beneficial effects for our bodies. One of them seems to be that it fights cancer. And so during the daytime, we don't have very much melatonin in our bloodstream. But at night, when it gets dark, there's a sensor in your eye that connects to the pineal gland in the brain, which manufactures melatonin. And when it gets dark, you don't even have to be asleep. Your brain produces lots of melatonin and injects it into the bloodstream. And that's where our melatonin is replenished at night. Now, if you happen to get up in the middle of the night and go to the bathroom or make a raid on the refrigerator for a late night snack, and you turn on the light, your melatonin crashes. The production crashes and the body has to start all over again. So it became apparent more than 30 years ago that people who have jobs that keep them up at night and exposed to light, think taxi drivers, emergency room nurses, graveyard workers working in a factory overnight, have their circadian rhythm, their day-night rhythm completely messed up by this constant exposure to light. And it turns out that those people have a higher risk of breast cancer in women, prostate cancer in men, just by their the disruption of their circadian system. This is a little graph that shows a lab experiment where laboratory mice were implanted with human breast cancer tumors. And then the researchers watched what happens. Some of those mice were exposed to constant light, and that's the curve here on the left, and the tumor growth was extremely rapid. And yet the mice that were kept in complete darkness, the open circles, their tumor growth was much slower because the amount of melatonin in their bloodstream was maintained. And so it's been determined and announced that shift work that involves this kind of circadian disruption is probably carcinogenic to humans. I would not want to be one of the people living in this apartment complex with all those lights shining into the windows at night. And here in the US, the American Medical Association has gotten into this and declaring that nighttime lighting disrupts all kinds of biological process and is potentially harmful to human health. So we know what the enemy is, and it's this light at night. And again, especially blue rich light. And finally, energy waste. Again, you've all seen these pictures of the Earth it's taken by satellites, how the lights of cities delineate all of the major places. This is the United States, and clearly you can make out all the major cities. Here's Florida down here, Los Angeles over on the lower left, Chicago and New York and New England up here where I live. If you look closely at this, there are some places here in North Dakota and in West Texas where there are no cities. There shouldn't be any light there. And these are places that have extensive oil production, fracking, where it goes on 24/7. And so all of those oil fields are lit up strongly with light and enough so to be seen easily from space. It's a pretty sad situation. Okay, so let's talk about light pollution near the Philippines, shall we? Here's a map, a color-coded map showing light pollution southern and Southeast Asia. Here's India over here on the left. Here's Vietnam, Hainan Island, the coast of China, Malaysia, and then here on the far right, here's the Philippines. And let's zoom in a little bit on that. Here are your islands, and obviously Luzon is the one that has the highest population and therefore the most light pollution. We were talking before we got started about how some of the outer provinces and even northern Luzon itself doesn't have much light pollution. Again, these are color-coded maps. So the reds are the most light pollution, yellows, greens, blues are pretty dark. So it turns out I can quantify this a little bit. I've zoomed in on Manila and its surroundings. I've drawn a box around it, and I've analyzed how much light pollution you have had over the last decade. And by the way, this is the, down here on the graph, this is the website that you want to go to, lighttrends.lightpollutionmap.info. And you can play the same game that I have anywhere that you want in the world, but especially there in the Philippines. And so this shows the growth in light pollution over the last decade or so, since 2013, as measured by satellites. And that dashed red line shows the increase, which turns out to be about 4% per year. Now, that's bad that it's that much, but it's only a lower limit. These modern satellites that take these photos looking down at the Earth are blind to blue light. So they see the red light, they see the green light, but they don't see the blue light. And I'm sure you're all aware that there's been a growth of LED light fixtures in the nighttime environment. Those are very strong in blue light often. And this is a problem worldwide. It's not just in the Philippines. I get increases like this all the time. So just 3 weeks ago in the journal Science, a team of light researchers, light pollution researchers, announced a result of an analysis of measurements taken around the world over the last 11 years. Oops, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do that. And what they found is that worldwide, there's been an increase in the sky brightness, in the sky glow, of from 7 to 10% per year. Now, from the standpoint of us trying to observe the stars, that is just not sustainable. That is a scary and sobering number. And it sort of goes back to the fact that these plots, when you make them, they're not showing you the full picture. And what they were able to do here, I'll get back to this, is that they're using observations made by citizens on the ground, actually measuring the brightness of the night sky. I'll get back to that in a second. So these LEDs, these light emitting diodes, have come on the scene. There's no way to understate how dramatically LEDs have affected our nighttime environment. It is a change in the way we light the night that happens once in multiple generations. The last time we've had a technology that has been so dramatically impactful was back in the 1950s and 60s. And so I have to say, LEDs are a phenomenal technology in terms of their energy efficiency, as shown by this plot here. We think we can get, 250 lumens, which is a measure of light, quantification of light per watt of electricity, whereas an incandescent bulb that everyone was using like 30 years ago is only about 10 lumens per watt. So they're dramatically efficient, and they can do all kinds of things extremely well. They can be dimmed, they can be made any color that you want. They can turn on and off, with no time delay at all, seconds, thousands of times a night if you want them to. But there's a dark side, if you will, an ugly side to these LEDs. So I'm going to introduce you to something called color temperature. For those of you who have studied astronomy and know about blackbody radiation, you know that the hottest stars are the bluest stars. They emit the greater of their light peaks at the blue end of the spectrum. And the cooler the star, the redder its appearance, the redder its spectrum. And so we, lighting people have taken this notion of this sort of color temperature equivalent for color and used it to describe the apparent color of lights. And so now when you get when you buy a light bulb, you're going to see a number on it, which is its color temperature in Kelvins, that ranges anywhere from, well, typically you're going to see them around, where you might buy them in a store, 3,000, 4,000, maybe 5,000. But you see here graphically the range of color temperatures. And in fact, here in the US, when you go to a store to buy a light, it tells you on the packaging what the color temperature is. That's a fairly new development on the labels of all the lighting that is purchased by the consumer and for commerce too as well. So I want to get back to this notion of rods and cones. Remember, our eyes at night are more sensitive to blue light. In fact, they are most sensitive to blue light. Before LEDs, a lot of our lighting was using what's called high pressure sodium or HPS lighting. It's got that kind of peachy color. You'll know it when you see it. It's not really white. It's kind of a warm glow. And that's because it really does not emit any blue light at all. All of its emissions are in the yellow and orange part of the spectrum. But compare that with what an LED does. These are two LEDs side by side. And just sort of intrinsically, an LED, a naked LED, if you will, creates a huge blue spike of emission. And you can, just like with a fluorescent bulb, you can change the color of an LED by taking that emission, coating the inside of the LED with a phosphor that absorbs the light and then re-radiates it with some other spectrum. And so this 3000K here, you see that the blue spike has been greatly diminished, and this will be a light that has a lot warmer color to it. The reason this is all important is the dashed line that you see in this plot. That dashed line is our sensitivity, our circadian sensitivity. That little sensor in your eye is most sensitive to blue light. And in particular, it is most sensitive exactly where LEDs put out the most light. And so this is why at night, if you're exposing your eyes to blue light from an LED or, your device, your phone, your TV screen at night, which has a lot of blue light in it, you're suppressing your melatonin production and you're not doing yourself any favors. So the three curves here are the dashed line is circadian sensitivity. The solid line is our photopic sensitivity during daylight. This is what our cones are sensitive to. And then this heavy black line is the output from a 5000K LED. Very bad news at all. I'm going to kind of skip through this. A lot of people will claim that 4000 LEDs, 4000K LEDs, are acceptable because they're just like moonlight. That's really not the case. The moonlight is actually a lot more similar to a very warm light than to a bluer LED. So I'm going to skip this. So the American Medical Association again weighed in on this just about 2016 and encouraged the use of 3000 Kelvin or lower in lighting for all outdoor installations. And I have to say, the person who was most responsible for this AMA policy is a cardiologist in the Boston area named Mario Mata. And you perhaps have heard his name. He is an outstanding amateur astronomer. Edwin, Imelda, and I have all known him for a very long time. He's got a 32-inch, that is not quite 1 meter, telescope in his house, mounted on his house that he observes with. He's quite the guy, but he has led the fight on this AMA policies. So what can we start? I'm gonna sort of segue here into what we can start to do. Maybe there are places in the Philippines that have not yet converted their street lights to LEDs. If so, you have a responsibility to your fellow stargazers and to yourselves to get involved in that selection process, because often LEDs are chosen by people who don't know anything about lighting. They pick a fixture that looks really nice during the daytime, and at night it can be horrible. Horrible not only from the standpoint of the color temperature, it's too hot, it's too strong, it's not shielded well, it creates a lot of glare. And so if you, throughout the Philippines, were to educate yourselves a little bit, just a little bit, about the good, bad, and ugly of outdoor lighting, you can make a difference if you can get in, if you can insert yourself in those discussions. I want to show you the leading edge of LED technology here. This is a little town nearby where I live that decided to change its streetlights to LEDs. And it turns out that there's a very active astronomer, amateur and professional astronomer, who lives in this town. And he convinced the town to install a bunch of test fixtures before they made the complete conversion, and to let the people in the town vote on which ones they liked best. And what they liked best was something that was a real warm color. So these are two side-by-side pictures that I took. One of these is the high-pressure sodium fixture that was replaced, and the other is an LED that has been installed. You can't really tell them apart. They have the same warm glow. Look at the street. It's got this warm glow on it. I haven't doctored these images at all. It's exactly as they were taken by the camera. Well, the one on the left is the LED. It creates less glare. You can see it's not as bright as the other one is. It's obviously lower cost. It's the one the citizens favored. And you can see that it actually covers the street more uniformly. So when I got involved with this game about 30 years ago, those of us who were fighting light pollution were seen as a little bit on the fringe, if you will. We were, you know, we were astronomers trying to preserve the darkness of our mountaintops, and we really had no grounding in the reality of everyday life. But now, all these years later, light pollution has become a kind of everyday topic when it comes to, you know, like preserving insects and pollinators and bird migrations, and for all this energy savings, all those reasons. And this is just an example of some of the stories that have run here in the U.S. having to do with light pollution. This National Geographic, by the way, this is downtown Chicago, sort of the poster child for bad lighting. So what I encourage you to do is, if you want a short version of what you're hearing this evening, is go to the IDA's website, darksky.org. That's your one-stop location for all things having to do with light pollution. And in particular, look for a short public affairs film called Losing the Dark. You can also find it on YouTube. And it's been translated into a whole bunch of different languages. It's about 10 minutes long, and it gives you a sort of snapshot, something that you could easily show to local officials, for example, about lighting. Now, an important development happened just within the last couple of years, where the IDA has partnered with a group called the IES, the Illuminating Engineering Society. This is an important group. They set all the standards for lighting here in North America. And so the two of them got together and have put forward these five principles for responsible outdoor lighting. And you can see them there. Light should be directed only where you need it, no brighter than necessary, only on when it needs to be, and the warmest color temperature possible. This is a sort of graphic that shows what we mean by those things a little bit. And this has really caught on. So this is the guiding principles for controlling light pollution. Now, there is something you can do, and I want to get back to this result from Science Magazine from a couple of weeks ago. You see here where it says, using 51,351 citizen scientist observations of naked eye stellar visibility. This was not satellite data. These were estimates of the naked eye limiting magnitude that people like you and I around the world took year after year after year. And the program that does that is called Globe at Night, globeatnight.org. I want you to all, when you're done here, whenever you hear this talk or see this talk, if you're watching it on Facebook or if you see it later, when you're done watching, I want you to go to globeatnight.org and make a difference in fighting light pollution. And it's really simple. You don't need any experience. You don't need any equipment. All you have to do is to be willing to go out under a clear, dark, moonless sky and to estimate how many stars you can see. And so you go to this website and it provides little maps like this that show you how many stars will be in the sky for various degrees of darkness. Magnitude is a number that astronomers use to describe how faint the stars can be seen. The higher the number, the fainter the stars, as these maps kind of indicate. So you go to the website and you can do this on your app, which has the advantage of already geolocating where you are. And you enter just a few pieces of information, the time and date, where you are, what the sky conditions are, or is there anything unusual? And then which of these little maps is closest to what you see in the sky? Make sure you give yourself a little time to dark adapt, at least 10 or 15 minutes before you make this observation. And then you hit send, and it becomes part of that global database that those scientists tapped into in order to make their results known. Now, there's a shortcut called a sky quality meter, or SQM. And as members of astronomy clubs, I encourage you to get one. This is what it looks like. It's the size of like a package of cigarettes. It's very simple. It's got a little button battery inside. And you can use it to make a quantified measurement of how dark the sky is. And you can include that in your globe at night observation, and it makes it much more valuable because it takes the guesswork out of it. You know, we humans, as we get older, our pupils don't expand as much at night. We can't see as faint a star as we could when we were younger. And so the sky quality meter takes the guesswork out, but it doesn't matter. You don't need that meter. You can just do this on your own. Do it over and over again, over the course of the year, over many years, and that will show you where things are going with respect to your night sky. So I called up the Globe at Night observations for in and around Manila for last year. And as near as I can tell, there were four. You can see them here barely. There's three little yellow circles, which suggests that you have pretty crappy skies in downtown Manila, as I would expect, right? Then over here, not far away, there's somebody who says that you had a limiting magnitude of 7, which I absolutely do not believe, absolutely at all. As I said, these are 2022 results. When you invite me back next year for next year's National Astronomy Week celebration, I want to be able to call up the 2023 map and have this whole area, the whole islands of the Philippines, peppered with globe at night measurements. I hope you will make that pact with me. That is your homework for the coming year, to get involved with this. At the end of the day, we can individually do something to fight light pollution, be it a globe at night measurement, or going to our local municipality and say, hey, tell me about the lights that you just installed, you know, or what did you ask of the developer that put in those awful lights, or maybe there's a development going in and you can control what lights get put in beforehand. The point is that we need to put in lights only when and where we need them and in just the amount necessary, because everything else is waste. It's waste. So here are a few key links for you. Here's my information, and there is my U.S. phone number. Please call me if you have a question or write me an email. I am very good about responding to people. This is what I do in retirement. I am very passionate about fighting light pollution. I want to make all of you passionate about fighting light pollution as well. And Jet, I'll turn the floor back to you. Thank you very, very much. Maybe we can take some questions.
Thank you so much, Kelly, for that very, very informative talk. As I mentioned, our group, both of us are here in the cities, and that really affects us. And we will take your challenge to start measuring, doing dark sky measurements of light pollution and try to come up with data for you next year, hopefully. So I would like to read some of the questions here in the chat box. One of the questions here is, does man-made lights affect nighttime lights from the sky? But, right. Does man-made lights affect nighttime lights from the sky?
And Tristan, yeah. I'm going to, by lights of the sky, stars, for example, okay? Yes, absolutely. I'll give you a real good example that's happening right now. You may have heard about this comet, ZTF, that has been cruising across the sky. And it is visible, but it is a soft object. You know, it's not a point. It's actually a fuzzy ball in the sky. The more light pollution you have, the less your chance of being able to find that, because it's an object like that really just kind of gets blended into the background of the light pollution. So absolutely, not just objects like that, but the stars themselves, are the faint ones are just obliterated from being able to be visible. That measurement of I was showing of magnitude, if you were in a, let me try to make it in simpler terms, if you were in a super dark location, there was no moon in the sky, no lights of any kind anywhere around, you might be able to see a couple of thousand stars, 2,000 stars, 3,000 maybe, with your eye in the nighttime sky. If you live in the middle of the city with a lot of sky glow making the sky bright, you guys who live in and near Manila can tell me better. If you see 30 stars, you maybe are seeing a lot, right? So that's how many stars you lose to light pollution. And so the less light pollution you have, the more stars you're going to be able to see. And, you know, if one thing I want to mention, we humans, long ago, there wasn't electricity and there were no street lights at night. And we evolved as humans, you know, a million years ago, being exposed to really bright daylight during the day. We spent a lot of time outside hunting and gathering and stuff like that. We were exposed to full spectrum sunlight during the day. And then at night, it was black. It was dark. We lived in a cave, maybe. And so this range between really bright days and really dark nights set our circadian rhythm very strongly, and we had very strong circadian rhythms. Now think about your everyday life. You spend your day maybe in an office or a school or, you know, some kind of building, and you never really get exposed to much direct sunlight. It's kind of a gray all the time. And then at night, we've kind of extended day into night. We're up until really late at night, or we watch TV or play with our devices. We go to the malls and the all night fast food places. And so we've really messed up our circadian rhythm in ways that we don't fully understand yet, but it can't be good.
Thank you, Kelly. I also like this, your discussion about the medical aspects of light pollution. And I look into it as well because I'm a medical doctor. Thank you about that. There's a question here from Mr. Tomas Encarnacion. How do observatories deal with light pollution, especially those located near urban areas? Do they have a way of dealing with light pollution, the observatories?
Debra will weigh in on this, but let me tell you what I think I know. And that is that observatories, there was a time when observatories were on the outskirts of what was then the city. At Harvard, there is an observatory in Cambridge, which was at one point a very, very dark location. In Sydney, there is an observatory on a hill in the middle of downtown Sydney. I'm sure that the observatory that was established there in Manila, I was trying to remember the slides, like maybe in the 1930s, if I remember right. At that time, it was probably a pretty dark location. Now those areas are completely swamped. Those telescopes, as beautiful as they were, and a lot of them are beautiful old refractors, are just used for outreach. They'll show you the moon and planets, and that's about it, because that's about all they can see any longer. And professional observatories are being affected as well. I'll just use the example of Tucson, Arizona, which is home to Kitt Peak National Observatory, the largest collection of professional telescopes in the United States. And it was during the 1980s that a couple of the astronomers there, Dr. David Crawford, noticed that the growth of neighboring Tucson was starting to affect the night sky from the top of Kitt Peak. And that's how the International Dark Sky Association got formed. It was initially, it was, you know, the scope was worldwide, but the focus initially was trying to get Tucson to diminish its lights. And they were very largely successful. Tucson is still, for the size of a city that big, it's still a pretty dark place. Debra, you want to talk about other locations?
Yeah, thanks, Kelly. What you said is exactly right, and this is affecting observatories everywhere, in some places more than others. Chile has done a good job of trying to control light pollution around the observatories there, although, again, lights are starting to affect even what were once very dark sites. South Africa is still doing a very good job because they have some very dark areas where their observatories are located. But it's a growing problem. At my campus, we have a 32-inch telescope in the middle of Poughkeepsie, New York, and the skies are not great there anyway, but at least we've been able to convince our administrators that we need downward pointing lights, and we also need to have control over those lights. We need safety, but we also need, if we have a deep exposure, the ability to turn off the lights. So very locally, you can have some influence over your observatories if you talk to the administration and convince them that if you're going to do some research or public outreach, that you need to be able to have regions where you really can control what the lighting is. But it's a problem everywhere.
Thank you. Thank you, Debra. Another question for Kelly from Mr. Raymond Ang, and this is some practical aspects. The question is, for colleges and universities in light polluted metro areas, metropolitan areas like in the Philippines, would you recommend investing in research projects using small to mid-sized telescopes rather than invest in large aperture telescopes that may be affected with light pollution?
Right. So, let's think about the kinds of objects that you can see through light pollution, which is still stars. And one of the most productive ways that even the telescopes in even light polluted areas can be useful in research, in you know, like actual contributions to science, is photometry of stars. That is measuring the brightness of stars or double stars, variable stars, all of that. And more recently, to measure the transits of exoplanets across the disks of distant stars. That is something that can be done from a light polluted area. And so in that particular case, as it has always been the case, the larger your aperture, the fainter the star you can see. So if you were to undertake a project involving any kind of stellar work, spectroscopy or photometry or astrometry, any of that involving stars, then that's where I think you will have the most success in a light polluted environment. If you're looking for trying to map the H2 regions and the galactic arms of a spiral galaxy or Andromeda galaxy or whatever, not so much because you can't see the faint stuff, but you can certainly see the stars. And so there's a whole range of opportunities, not only for small apertures, but for large apertures as well.
Thank you, Kelly. And this is another good question regarding addressing the problem of light pollution from Mr. Christian DiMacali. Hi, thanks for the great talk. I am an IDA advocate and always share about light pollution and dark skies to the general public, but I'm having a hard time reaching out to politicians or other officials. Do you have any tips for me to reach out to these people in power?
Yes, I do, Christian. Let me give you two bits of advice. Then, first of all, thank you for being an IDA advocate. IDA advocates are individuals like Christian. They're not engaged in a club, although I am certain that the National Astronomical League of the Philippines will very quickly have a light pollution committee on it, right? right?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Good. So, as an individual, if you have an existing problem, let's say there's a mall, or something, then what I would do is I would talk to the officials or talk to the mall owners. Let's say, look, you're not going to change your lights, but maybe you can shield them, or maybe they're LEDs, in which case almost every LED has the ability to be dimmed. There could be a switch inside the housing, and the light is brighter than it needs to be, or maybe that LED can be a timer can be attached to turn it off when there's nobody at the mall. You know, you think of a big mall, they have huge parking lots that are completely empty at night. Sure, you want to protect the building, but you don't need to protect all that asphalt. So maybe you can convince them to just turn off the lights at night. That's for existing facilities. This applies to municipal facilities as well. In terms of the really easy victories are for the things that have not yet been built. And so, Christian, what I would encourage you to do locally or even nationally is find out what the, you know, I don't know how utilities work in the Philippines, but if there is a national utility that provides all of the power, what is that utility's plan for converting streetlights to LEDs just nationwide in the Philippines? If you can find the right person, you can affect something simple like the color temperature of those lights. Maybe they're planning to put in 4,000, you can convince them to do 3,000. Or maybe here's something that nobody really understands unless you point it out to them. A given light has a lumen output. And so if you replace an existing, that orange high pressure sodium light with a blue rich LED, and they have the same number of lumens, the LED will look much brighter because of the blue light. One of the demonstrations that I use is I go to the hardware store and I buy two small LED bulbs that are exactly the same output, but one is 2700 Kelvin, which is typical in a hardware store. It's got a nice warm light. And the other is, say, 4,000. It's a bluer light. They have the same lumen output. And I turn them on at the same time. And the blue one looks a lot brighter because of our eye sensitivity to blue light. And it gives a very good demonstration that you don't need as many lumens with an LED as you used to. These are the kinds of things that the IDA advocacy program, and Christian, again, I'm glad that you're an IDA advocate. I hope you've tuned into some of the tutorials that we've had. You can be taught these basics about lighting by the IDA. We have a whole series of tutorials that can bring you along step by step and make you much more conversant and much more expert at the, you know, what goes into lighting, good lighting and bad lighting.
Thank you, Kelly. We will make sure that the Astronomical League of the Philippines, and we will also join our other astronomical groups to also be IDA advocates as well. Thank you so much. And those are very practical tips, how to address those questions with our administrators and politicians. I think I have to, I read the last question. This is a technical question, Kelly. How does light pollution or smog make light pollution worse? How does pollution or smog make light pollution worse? How many orders of magnitude? How about the humidity? Given the tropics have hot and humid air, then air pollution added to light pollution. And a follow-up, are specific colors or wavelengths of light more impacted by smog or water vapor in the air? Which ones are more scattered by the smog or water vapor?
Very good, very good. Those are great questions. We have this too in the United States. During our summers, the air is often very hazy. There's a lot of aerosol content in the atmosphere. And so just air molecules themselves, no haze, no smog, just the molecules themselves will scatter light. That's why the sky is blue. It's a process called Rayleigh scattering. And it turns out that photons of light are scattered according to the inverse fourth power of their wavelength. What that means in practical terms is that blue light is scattered something like 16 times more readily than red light is. And so at night, every blue photon that goes out from an outdoor light at night is going to create a whole lot more scatter than a red or leave an amber or warmly colored light would be. That's why the name of the game, the success will come with trying to reduce as much of the blue light as we can. When you get aerosols in the atmosphere, those are actual particulate bits of particles, be they, you know, smog particles or air particles, water vapor, you know, just fog and that sort of thing, then those are large enough to scatter all wavelengths of light, not just the blue ones. And so the scattering becomes much, much worse. You all know that the sky seems to glow a lot more when there's haze and cloud around than when it's a clear, transparent night. And that's how it gets affected by the wavelength of light. There was an interesting study in Los Angeles undertaken by atmospheric scientists here in the United States. It turns out that light pollution makes smog worse. Light pollution from a city makes smog worse over Los Angeles. And it's too complicated to try to get into now. But there was a feedback mechanism that LA has a pretty bad problem with smog, and it's made worse by the fact that there are all these lights shining into the sky at night.
Well, thank you, Kelly. There's another question here in the Q&A from Mr. Jason Callow. Hi, thank you for the good discussion. I am involved in a research for light pollution here in the Philippines. One of the obvious contributors of ALAN is the digital billboard. I think right. These are the LED digital billboards, right, which we see a lot in our streets. No? Right. In your country, is there a standard size, luminosity, and kind of graphics that should be considered in the said billboards?
Yeah, that's a great question, Jason. Not a lot of cities have lighting regulations for billboards. But I'm sure in the Philippines, if you have a problem, we have a problem here. It's a growing problem. A lot more communities are paying attention to these digital billboards and creating regulations for them. There is no standard nationwide. It's on a city by city basis. Typically what happens is that you want the light intensity at night to be far lower than it is during the day because there's no daylight competition. And the metric that is used to determine the brightness of a billboard is something called a nit, N-I-T. It's candela per meter squared. And so when you're trying to determine how bright you can allow a billboard to be, let's say you wanted to create a regulation, you would regulate the nits that billboard puts out per square, you know, it's an amount of light per square area. And there are some towns that have regulations. If you want to look up, that would be a great question to bring up at an IDA advocates meeting. But as a shortcut, I know, for example, that the city of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania in the United States, has a billboard limit of something like, I'm just guessing here, like 100 nits at nighttime, as in an attempt to try to control the brightness. And billboards are really bad because they're shining out horizontally and because they're LEDs, there's a lot of light that goes up, a lot of light that goes down. There is some emerging technology that controls the emission angle of the light from a billboard, but it's not very widespread, unfortunately, not yet.
Thank you, Kelly. Thank you so much for patiently answering all our questions. In the interest of time, we have to proceed unless some of our panelists have a question or two. Well, if none, let me take this opportunity, Kelly, to give you our Certificate of Appreciation from the Astronomical League of the Philippines. This certificate is presented to J. Kelly Beatty, for his invaluable insights, experiences, and expertise shared with the participants for his talk, The Fight Against Light Pollution, held as part of the ALP NAW 2023 opening program given this 19th of February 2023, signed by President James Kevin T. and Jose Francisco Aguilar, Vice President. Thank you so much, Kelly. And I hope to see you again next year. But before we proceed, can we have a group picture with all of the participants now?
There you go.
Andrew, you cannot open your on the screen. Yeah, that's good. Okay.
All right.
Ready? 1, 2. Wait. 1, 2, 3. One more. 1, 2, 3.
James, June is not here.
June is there.
Ah, there. June is here. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. One more.
Are we good?
1, 2, 3. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Terrific.
Warren.
Thank you.
Kelly.
Thanks, Kelly. Thanks, Debbie. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you for that certificate. I'll look forward to that.
Thank you.
We will mail it to you. Okay. Thank you. So thank you so much. That was a great talk and very informative and very useful for us here in the Philippines as well. Our next talk will be given by two esteemed Filipino amateur astronomers and my two dear friends. Aside from the initiators and founders of the Philippine National Astronomy Week celebration, as mentioned earlier by James, our two speakers are also the first two Filipinos who had an asteroid named after them. In 1995, the International Astronomical Union named asteroid 6282 Edwelda in their honor. Edwin Aguirre and Imelda Joson started in the Philippine Astronomical Society, or otherwise known as PAS, where they were very active members, then officers. Even after they migrated to the United States, they have established firm connections to and are still dedicated to the advancement and growth of science, especially in the field of astronomy in the Philippines. They will talk about their journey and experiences in the hopes that they will inspire others to jump across limitations and, as they say, reach for the stars. Ladies and gentlemen, let us welcome Edwin Aguirre and Imelda Joson.
Thank you so much, Jet, for that wonderful introduction.
Yeah. Good morning to everybody there in the Philippines. And do you want to start?
Yeah, we'll get started. Let me just share our screen.
Okay. I need to do PowerPoint first, I think.
Okay, let's share slides. Start from the beginning.
Yeah. Oh, I think how do you do this, Jet? Because the full screen is not showing. Huh?
We can see your full screen. We can see your
You can
screen.
See the full screen. Okay. Because the
ours is blocked by the panelists. So you can see the whole frame.
Yeah, I can see it. You can adjust your, but of course, if it's not a bother with you so much with the presentation. You can just keep on advancing. Yeah.
Yeah. We'll do a different gallery view. Where's the gallery view?
Just choose a speaker view.
Yeah. Can't see the button.
Maybe it's down there. Is that the one?
Not sure. Nope. I can't see the gallery button. Anyway, go ahead.
Okay. We are brought into this world through the love and commitment of two very special people, our parents. They provide us with affection, guidance, care, and protection, and they endure so many personal sacrifices in order to give us the best they could in terms of health and nutrition, a happy home to grow, good education, to achieve our full potential, and so much more. Ultimately, we become a reflection of our parents, not just in the continuation of their genetic lineage, but also in the perpetuation of their sense of family values, traditions, dreams, and aspirations. There comes a time in life, though, when we seek to become independent from our parents, a time to make our own choices and decide on the path we would like to take. This is when our lives become our own journey of survival, a journey filled with ups and downs, challenges and successes, lessons learned and lessons taught. Before long, we too would get married and become parents, and the cycle continues. This is our life on Earth. For both Edwin and I, our childhood curiosity and sense of imagination have taken us on a lifelong journey of exploration and discovery. In our study of both the microscopic and macroscopic realms of the natural world, we have come to observe and understand that there are only two things certain in this world, birth and death. Everything born ultimately has to die, from viruses and bacteria, the blue whale, the largest known animal ever to have existed on planet Earth. This also includes the countless stars that populate our visible universe. It is therefore important for us to understand that our physical existence on this planet is very much limited. How we'd like to use that time between birth and death, and how we'd like us to be remembered, is very much up to us. Let's hope that the examples and lessons our parents have taught us, and the knowledge we've amassed from years of education in school, and the lessons we've learned throughout our everyday lives, would guide us in making the right choices in order to create a positive contribution to society, to humanity, and to our planet and all that live in it. I still clearly remember when, as a child, my fascination for the night sky started. One evening, I found my mom and her siblings looking out the window facing the western sky. I asked what they were doing, to which my mom replied, they were looking for a comet. When I asked what a comet is, she looked at me with a brief pause, then said, it's a witch riding a broom. In my mind, I had this image of a Disney character of a witch riding a broom. I knew I needed to see this. I stayed way past my bedtime, even skipping dinner, keeping an eye in the sky as the intense orange glow started to disappear and it got darker and darker. That witch must have zoomed through the sky without me seeing it. But when I saw the points of lights with varying sizes and colors and twinkling like diamonds in the veil of the night, it was magical. As the hours went by, they appeared to move through the firmament. I couldn't wait to flip the pages of my encyclopedia to read about that witch on a flying broom, or rather, that comet. Of course, I couldn't understand much of what I read back then. I was only 5. But that night I discovered that there is a whole different world beyond where my feet stands. I didn't stop until I understood what comets are. And years later, even wrote a book about comets. Finally, I told my mom that it may have taken me years to understand what the witch riding a broom is all about, that the broom represents the comet's tail. Back then, there was no internet, no Google, no Siri or Alexa. We only had books and encyclopedias. binoculars, and telescopes. But most importantly, we have our curiosity, our passion to learn and understand. Answers didn't come quickly as they do now, but in our search for truth and knowledge, we began one of the most enjoyable and intellectually fulfilling journey of our lives. Now we understand that those points of lights are actually stars or other suns shining through the process of thermonuclear fusion, that the light reaching our eyes at any one given moment have traveled at the speed of 186,282 miles per second over great distances. Some took only years to reach us, but others may have taken hundreds of thousands, even millions of years. That is why, when we look up at the night sky, we actually see back in time. As we look at our own sun, we are actually looking back 8 minutes ago. When we look at Alpha Centauri, the next closest star to us aside from our sun, we are seeing the light from almost 5 years ago. When we look at the Andromeda galaxy, we are seeing the light from approximately 2 million years ago, when there were still no modern human roaming the Earth. Our knowledge of this universe is based on what our instruments can detect and what our minds can comprehend. As science and technology progresses, so does our understanding of this cosmos. Join us as we take a quick journey, ex terra ad astra et retro, from the Earth to the stars and back. This is our personal motto. We live on a very unique planet that is approximately 4.5 billion years in age, in a solar system that is located in the Orion arm of a barred spiral galaxy we call the Milky Way. Our species is only one of about 8.7 million species that call Earth as home. Although it was just in the past 2 million years that the human species emerged on Earth, it wasn't until just about 300,000 years ago that Homo sapiens sapiens, or modern man, appeared. But in the past 300,000 years, we have made significant progress from, from being hunter-gatherers to builders and explorers of worlds even beyond Earth. Living in a non-light polluted world, early modern men were so fascinated with those points of lights they saw marching in the night sky. The ancient Arab and Chinese astrologers began mapping them and naming patterns, thus the birth of constellations and celestial cartography. In 1609, Galileo Galilei used his telescope and had a closer view of objects in the heavens. But the science of astronomy continued to evolve with bigger and better telescopes, more accurate calculations, and the birth of astronomical photography, which expanded our understanding of the night sky. From a rudimentary telescope with which Galileo made drawings of the surface of the moon, to the giant telescopes at Mount Wilson, Palomar, Mauna Kea, La Silla, to the Hubble Space Telescope, and now the James Webb Space Telescope, humanity continues to see deeper into space and in time. It wasn't until the 1960s, or just about, my apologies for this, I'm having dry throat right now. It wasn't until the 1960s, or just about 60 years ago, when a new chapter in astronomical exploration began, when human ingenuity and the marvels of engineering allowed us to send astronauts to the moon and even collect samples and send unmanned probes to explore other planets, moons, asteroids, and comets. We have even sent probes to study the atmospheres of distant worlds and landed robotic rovers and spacecrafts equipped with science labs to study the compositions of rocks and also try to find any microbial life form on the surface of Mars. We have come a long way from when early explorers journeyed to uncharted territories to find new land on Earth, to modern robotic explorers giving us a better understanding of our own solar system. The dedication and work of many scientists have expanded our knowledge of what is even beyond our solar system, to the realm of nebulae and galaxies. We have come to understand that nebulae, my apologies, Edwin is so slow in pushing the button here. We have come to understand The dedication and work of many scientists have expanded our knowledge of what is even beyond our solar system. To the realm of nebulae and galaxies, we have come to understand that nebulae are either stellar nurseries or remnants of dying stars. They are giant clouds of dust and gas floating in interstellar space. Most nebulae and galaxies we observe today have been painstakingly cataloged and mapped. And beyond our own Milky Way galaxy, populating the vast universe, are millions and millions of other galaxies that are made up of billions and billions of stars and solar systems. It just makes us wonder how vast the universe truly is. Now we ask not what those points of lights are up in the night sky, for we have now unraveled the secrets of stars, their birth, their sources of energy, and even how they die. We now know that our universe is approximately 13.8 billion years old, and that our own Milky Way galaxy is about 13.6 billion years in age. But rather, we now ask about gravitational lensing and gravitational waves, gamma ray bursts, quasars and pulsars, black holes, dark matter, and dark energy. Do we really live in a universe or a multiverse? Scientists are now exploring planetary systems in other stars. The more questions we answer, the more questions we ask. For humans are by nature never contented. For without that desire, that driving force to learn more, humanity would have accomplished nothing. But what is most important is that in our study of the vastness of space and the infinity of time, that we realize how insignificant we are in the totality of creation. And amidst the cosmic proportions and harmony of the universe, we are brought to humility. From humility, we find wisdom, and from wisdom, we learn survival. We have devoted decades of our lives exploring and trying to understand the worlds beyond our planet, but only to find ourselves even more fascinated with our own planet Earth and all that live in it. The only planet we know of that has the perfect conditions for harboring life. Earth is teeming with life. From the depths of the oceans and caverns to every corner of every continent on this planet, there is life, each with its own purpose, its own reason for being here. The complexity of life on Earth and the symbiotic relationship of each one is truly awesome and humbling to see. Our planet is about 4.5 billion years old. It took a billion years for Earth's condition to be ripe for early life form. But in that 4.5 billion year history of our planet, there have been 5 major mass extinction events. The Ordovician Silurian extinction some 440 million years ago, the Devonian extinction some 365 million years ago, The permanent Triassic event some 250 million years ago, the Triassic Jurassic some 210 million years ago, the Cretaceous Tertiary 65 million years ago. Through fossil records, we now know that prokaryotes like cyanobacteria became the dominant life form for 2 billion years. They were responsible for fixing the carbon dioxide in the water and was responsible for producing oxygen through photosynthesis. During the Cambrian period, about 521 million years ago, trilobites appeared on Earth. They're one of the most successful life forms on early Earth, having survived for about 270 million years, after which they became extinct during the Permian extinction event some 252 million years ago. It wasn't until 1796 that humans began to understand that life forms on Earth can go extinct. Climate change is sadly real and a natural process of Earth. But right now, we humans, our behavior is accelerating. Many scientists believe that we are now on the sixth extinction event, and it is because of humans. Only the tardigrades or water bear, a microscopic life form, survived all five extinction events. Will it survive the sixth? Will we humans survive the Holocene extinction? Modern man, Homo sapiens sapiens, that is us, our species, have only been around for some 300,000 years. Yet in that short time span, we have achieved so much. From using crude tools to growing our own food supply, to inventing language, writing, music, art, to sending man to the moon, to inventing the internet, to sending rovers to Mars, to creating human-like robots, humanity is capable of doing so much good, but it is also capable of destroying its own species and taking along with it many other species. Our planet is resilient. It will survive. But what may not survive are the beautiful and innocent inhabitants of Earth, those that are just doing what they're here for. The root cause of many of our earthly problems is the overpopulation of the human species. Because of it, we need to grow more food to sustain our ever-growing population. So we result in overfishing our oceans using synthetic fertilizers and pesticides in our farming method, which then destroys the soil's ecosystem, resulting ultimately in soil loss. Society have also placed too much emphasis in consumerism, that we over-harvest our natural resources, or worse, develop products that are harmful and destructive to our planet, to ourselves, and to many other life forms that call Earth as home. Consumerism is what causes our factories to produce greenhouse gases, contributing to the acceleration of climate change. We also produce so much waste because of this addiction to consumerism, some of which won't biodegrade in our lifetime. Some even contaminate our oceans and end up in the fish we eat. PFOA and PFAS, the forever chemicals, are now on most of the water we drink. Animals go extinct in our lifetime because of overhunting and trophy hunting. They also go extinct because of the pesticides we use on a daily basis. In the 1950s, peregrine falcons, one of the most majestic birds around, the fastest animal on the planet, were lost east of the Mississippi, and their population took a dive throughout the world due to the use of the chemical dichlorodiphenyltrichloroethane, or popularly known as DDT. DDT was used to kill insects, which were the food for the songbirds, which in turn are the food for the predatory birds. DDT then went up the food chain. Conservationists and the government added the bird to the endangered species list and gave it protection, banned the use of DDT, and went to work to reintroduce the birds to areas where they were lost. Here in Massachusetts, we became a part of this effort for about 16 years now. We helped Dr. Tom French of the Massachusetts Division of Fisheries and Wildlife, the biologist responsible for bringing back the population of peregrine falcons in our state. We monitor the pair daily and rescue their young during nesting season. It is one of the few success stories of conservation efforts here. But we don't only save these birds because they're beautiful, but because they're needed to balance the ecosystem. They are the natural control for smaller birds. While helping them, we've learned so much from them too. Watching their behavior gave us a better understanding and appreciation of our very own lives. We've been privy to their everyday lives for the past 16 years. They may not have soft and comfortable beds, but just pebbles in their nest. They may not have signature clothing, just the feathers on the back of to protect them from the elements. They may not have Rolex watches to tell them the time, but they know based on the position of the sun. They may not have books or televisions or video games, just the natural world to watch and to entertain them. They live a stressful life each day. They have to be on constant guard to protect their territory. They have to endure the extreme changes in the weather each day and as the season changes and as climate change gets worse, they have to adapt. They won't be able to have a meal if they don't catch prey at least twice a day, but they go on. They take care of the needs of their young. They mate for life. They teach their chicks how to fly, how to hunt, and they lead by example until their young are ready to be on their own and find their respective territories. And here we are humans complaining of being stressed each day. Some of our pollinators are also at risk of going extinct because of pesticides. If not for them, we won't have agriculture. We won't be able to grow our food without resulting in synthetic methods. Suburban America have turned to having lawns rather than gardens. They plant low-maintenance bushes rather than pollinator-friendly plants. Their lawns are like golf courses fed with so much synthetic and carcinogenic fertilizers and pesticides. We see that every day in our own neighborhood. They even kill and drive away wildlife because they defecate on their precious grass, not realizing that those poop are organic matter that feed the soil. Yet, unlike them, we buy a lot of composted chicken manure to feed our own grass. We use corn gluten as pre-emergent weed control. We mulch mow to return the nutrients of the grass back to the soil. Yes, our lawn looks like a golf course, too, but done in an organic way. The wildlife that visits our garden are the ones responsible for controlling whatever pests there are. Possums and wild turkeys peck and eat ticks. Rabbits control the weeds, and the bees and butterflies pollinate the organic vegetable garden. Our earthworm-rich soil doesn't only feed the small birds that visit, but the worm poop, the vermi compost they produce, enriches our soil even more. It can be done, and we've proven it. To help the pollinators, we've decided not only to have a pollinator-friendly garden, but to harvest the eggs and hatch monarch butterflies whose population has gone down significantly due to deforestation in their wintering sites. We've added milkweed to our garden where adult monarchs deposit their eggs. We then harvest them and watch as they metamorphose into beautiful monarch butterflies before releasing them back to the wild, where the fourth or fifth generation will make the 3,000-mile journey to Mexico.
We have a video to play.
Yeah, that's the video, actually. Sorry about that.
This one?
Yeah. Oh, I think it didn't do it as a... Oh, there you go.
Yeah. So we'll just show a video clip.
So the fourth and fifth generation will make the 3,000-mile journey to Mexico.
We love you. Safe journeys, baby. Safe journeys, okay? The baby. Put out your proboscis and eat. It's a female. And it's holding on to me. Okay, baby, you're free. Looking around, baby. Don't be afraid. Okay, I'm gonna let you go, baby.
So this one that we release will make the 3,000-mile journey to Mexico, where it will spend the winter months before heading back up north in spring. As we do this, we also use this opportunity to teach the neighborhood kids about science, for mentoring is important. Our journey have inspired us and have opened our minds to the true beauty of this world and to the true meaning of success. That success is not just about accumulating material wealth, but rather it is about using our God-given talents for the betterment of all. It is not about selfishness and greed. It is about selflessness, about mentoring, about helping others bring out the best in them. It is not about taking advantage of others for our own agenda, but it is about leaving a good legacy behind. A legacy that will educate and inspire, that others may do the same. It made us understand that we are the caretakers of planet Earth, that each one of us have a role and a responsibility to fulfill, a purpose for being on this planet. That we are a part of the symbiosis on Earth, that life doesn't revolve around us. Instead, we are just a tiny part of this planet's ecosystem. We are the authors of our own life story. Each day we live is like a page in our book of life. How colorful and vivid we'd like it to be depends solely on us. I would like to give to read a quote from Dr. Carl Sagan. In the last few millennia, we have made the most astonishing and unexpected discoveries about the cosmos and our place within it. Discoveries which are exhilarating to consider. They remind us that humans have evolved to wonder, that understanding is a joy, and that knowledge is prerequisite to survival. I believe our future depends on how well we know this cosmos, in which we float like a morning dust, the morning sky, mote of dust in the morning sky, end of quote. Thank you and have a good day, friends.
You have to stop screen share first.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Thank you so much, Imelda. That was a very beautiful and inspiring talk, really. So,
thank you. I'm just the slide operator.
Also, great work, Edwin.
Had to keep up with her. So, by the way, aside from the space photos, you know, photos taken by Hubble and James Webb Space Telescope, all the photos you saw on our presentation were taken by us. Yeah, so we took those photos, especially those photos taken from our backyard garden.
Very beautiful. Yeah. So do we have questions from our... I don't see any questions. I think that was a very, very clear presentation. I don't see any questions in our chat box. But do we have questions from our co-panelists or remarks?
I have one. Yes. I'd like to take this opportunity to actually thank you guys, Edwin and Dada, for the benefit of everyone tuning in. These two wonderful persons are my mentors while I was in my youth years, and they are actually the ones responsible for molding me to where I am now. They pushed me to be inspired by astronomy, stargazing itself, and until today, hands off to both of them. My full respect to Edwin and Dada for taking good care of me when I was in my youth years, trying to learn astronomy. And if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't actually be here today. So thank you guys. Thank you very much for being my mentors.
That was very touching. Thank you so much. You know, Edwin and I do our best in everything, in every, you know, journey we take, and hoping that we can reach even one and change one person, and, you know, inspire even one to go into the sciences. And
yeah, that's our personal measure of success, making a difference in somebody's life. And thank you, Peter, for that testimonial. That was nice and unexpected. And we still remember first meeting you during one of the monthly meetings of the Philippine Astronomical Society at the Manila Science High School. Yeah, so yes,
thank you.
That was a long time ago, but thank you. Yeah, we appreciate your words and your, you know.
Yeah, if we're going black, our apologies. Edwin and I haven't had sleep for a week.
You know, we've been taking care of our, you know, taking turns, taking care of our baby, our cat.
Thank you. Thank you also, Peter, for the heartwarming sharing.
Yeah.
We have a question here from the former president of the Philippine Astronomical Society, I think last year. Is that correct, James? Christian Dimakali.
Yes, yes.
Hi. The question from Christian is, hi, could you share something about the activities that happened on the first celebration of the National Astronomy Week?
Oh, well, that was a long time ago.
Maybe how it came about that you decided to propose National Astronomy Week. Maybe that would be a nice way to
share that. Well, we, you know, like as usual, Imelda and I do our brainstorming session, trying to find ways on promoting astronomy in the Philippines. And during one of those sessions, it was just the two of us. I believe this was late 1980s. Yeah, 80s. That's how the book on Halley's Comet also came about, during one of our brainstorming sessions. So
I mean, it's like last year when we had the National Astronomy Week celebration and you invited us to give a talk, and it was my first Zoom talk. And then what did I say? Hey, this would be a good opportunity to start a speaker series.
So that's what we have ongoing.
So it's similar to how the National Astronomy Week celebration happened. Well, back then, astronomy in the Philippines, you know, there was just a few people that you will actually see attending the meeting at the Manila Science High School. and
Dustin.
Yeah, the same people over and over and over. And so when Edwin and I got started in astronomy, you know, as kids, people would always say back then, you know, we would be very excited sharing what we saw through the telescope the night before. But people were like, ah, I don't want to stay up the whole night. You know, I'm not that kind of person, or I don't want to deal with the mosquitoes at night, you know, at the observatory, because they're, you know, being in the Philippines, there's a lot of mosquitoes at night. So that's how we got started with astrophotography. And then we wanted to share our photos, and that's how we got started with writing for the newspapers, for Manila Bulletin was the first one.
Started our science journalism career.
Yeah, Manila Bulletin was the first one who published our photo, and then we started writing articles for Manila Bulletin, the Daily Express, Malaya, Manila Times, Philippine Star, and a few others. And so sometimes it's just, you know, the need there. You see the need that you need to promote something. You need to promote the science. You need to share your passion. And that's how
it. Yeah. Well, going back to the first National Astronomy Week, this was probably late 1989 or early 1990 when we had that brainstorming session, and we said, it's good, you know, it's good that the PAS, the Philippine Astronomical Society, at that time was conducting its own, you know, stargazing sessions, a lot of overnight stargazing at the Manila Observatory in Quezon City. But we said, we need to make this national. We need to get the government involved and the other organizations. So we need something that would actually push them to work and cooperate in doing this promotion of astronomy, not just in Manila or Metro Manila, but the entire country. So we said, why not, you know, get an official declaration from the Philippine government? So that's when we had the idea of proposing for this. Initially, we wanted a National Astronomy Day, but they said, it's better if it's a week. So at least if the weather doesn't cooperate, you still have other days, you know, to celebrate.
And I remember Edwin writing the actual proclamation.
No, before the writing, we proposed the idea, and we approached the office of the executive secretary of President Cory Aquino. And the person said, you know, it would be easier and a lot faster if you just write the proclamation yourself, and then the president will just sign it. So that's what we did. So we went home and I drafted the proclamation, and I have to do some research on the legal language of a presidential proclamation, how it's done. And so I used that as a template. And of course, Mel and I have to come up with the various reasons why astronomy needs to be celebrated in the first place. That's why we came up with several reasons in the proclamation. And then we submitted it. And
we actually hand-delivered
it. Yeah, we went to Malacañang, hand-delivered the letter to the secretary.
Yeah, she met us at the sitting room.
Yeah, the music room, I think. To the personal secretary of Cory Aquino. And they said they'll get in touch with us. And then a few days later, we found out that through the mail, they mailed us a copy of the proclamation. And so Pag-asa was able to join in the celebration.
Yeah,
and
Dr. Roman Quintanar was very, very supportive.
The National Museum Planetarium.
Yeah.
The Pag-asa Planetarium in Quezon City. So there was actually a committee that was formed to coordinate all the planning of, you know, the activities throughout the week. And what is amazing is the president signed the proclamation March 26, and the opening of the National Astronomy Week was April 16. So we only had like 2 weeks to put together a program. And fortunately, all the other agencies at the Department of Science and Technology, you know, gave their support. And so we had, I think there was conferences at UP.
Yeah.
UP Diliman. And there were stargazing sessions at the Manila Observatory and free public showing at the National Museum Planetarium in Luneta. And what else?
We went out to give lectures also to various schools.
Yeah. So throughout the week, it was a very
but active. You have to remember.
No internet at that time.
No. Also,
no social media.
You have to remember that the observatory, through Father Badillo, who was very, very,
very supportive. Yeah,
he opened up the roof deck of the observatory for people to come and join.
So every night, every clear night, there was a stargazing session.
Yeah, and we were so used to it already because of Halley's Comet. Remember, Peter, you were there during Halley's Comet when we had to conduct not just our research on Halley, but also the people who were coming, hundreds of people coming.
Yeah, and also we gave talks about astronomy at various schools, you remember. So, and it was covered.
We were back then very young, so we had all the energy.
Yeah, and it was it got good coverage in the local daily newspapers like Manila Bulletin, Inquirer, Chronicle.
Yeah, that's the other one, Philippine Daily Inquirer.
Yeah, so that's how it got started. And
okay. Edwin, why February, third week of February in particular?
Well, that actually was decided by the officers of the Astronomical Society because of the weather situation.
I think weather is much better during February.
And the kids are still in school.
Yeah. And it's not too hot, not too cold. So
so that's why it's not April or...
Yeah,
April where summer.
April gets too hot, and then December there's so much activity. So we said probably February would be good. That's why the second National Astronomy Week, which was inaugurated by Vice President Salvador Laurel, was held on the 3rd February of 1992.
This is in 1992. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
So I read another comment here or question from, you know him, I think, Thomas Encarnacion. He said, would you recommend that while we look up to the stars, that we too need to look at the microscopic life just for the fun of looking? Yeah.
Tom, it's not just for the fun of looking, but, you know, you're going as one of the slides we presented there that, you know, we look through the microscope, see the microscopic and see the macroscopic, and you're going to see patterns there, and it is so amazing that, you know, we're not just small compared to the universe, but there's stuff that are smaller than us and they have their own world, and
it's a whole universe of microscopic organisms, and it's very fun to explore and study, and even just for fun. You don't have to be taking up biology
or microbiology
to enjoy the microscopic life.
Agree. Thank you. There's a comment here from Alan, our own Alan Yu. That's a very big telescope for Australia's private observatory. I would be happy to know if such a big instrument has been offered in the Philippines too.
Well, Alan, the first one on the slide there that you saw, the white tube, that was for the Department of Science. We were asked to build that telescope.
That's a 17 and a half inch telescope, Newtonian telescope. I think it's f4.5, and there's two of them we made. One is the wooden box.
That's the one that went to Australia.
Yeah,
we were commissioned by a German anthropologist who was living in the Philippines back then, and he was moving to Australia.
He said he has dark skies and he wanted an observatory. So I think he wanted to turn it into an educational tool for the residents there. And then Dr. Seferino Foliosco of the Department of Science and Technology found out that we built a telescope and it was sold to a scientist in Germany. So he commissioned us to build a second one, which is the one with the white tube. Yeah. So it's the same size in terms of primary mirror, 17 and a half inches.
Yeah, back then that was the biggest telescope in the country.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So
thank you. So I guess we have to proceed because yes. We have one more speaker. Thank you so much again, Imelda, Deda, and Edwin.
And, yes, my pleasure.
I would like to take this opportunity to give you our own certificate of appreciation. And this certificate is presented to Imelda Joson and Edwin Aguirre for their invaluable insights, experiences, and expertise shared with the participants for their talk From the Earth to the Stars and Back, held as part of the ALP NAW 2023 opening program, given this 19th of February of 2023, signed by James Kevin T, President and Vice President Jose Francisco Aguilar. Thank you.
Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you for inviting us.
Okay, we'll proceed. Our next, the last but not the least speaker is none other than our very own ALP Observation Committee Chair, Peter Benedict Tubalinal, nicknamed Sky. He is an amateur astronomer who has long been doing astrophotography with the only means he has, which is a smartphone. He started mobile astrophotography since 2016 and has been consistent using this kind of method until today. And I guess the cameras are much better now, Peter. Peter has been a member of the Astronomical League of the Philippines since 2006, where he also started organizing ALP's Messier Marathon on the same year. He has completed spotting all 110 Messier objects 4 times. Wow. Peter is also a lecturer for several stargazing sessions and astronomy conventions hosted by ALP. Being a diehard for stargazing and observational astronomy, he has earned the seat of being the current chairman of the ALP's Observations Committee. Today, he's giving his talk on observing the night using small telescopes and also sharing his experience in mobile astrophotography. Peter, thank you.
Thank you very much there, Doc Chet. And welcome once again to everyone. So let me share my screen now. All right, so can you see it, guys?
Yes. Good.
Thank you. All right. So let's begin. Good morning, afternoon, and evening, everyone from around the globe. Let me share with you my presentation, which is about observing the sky with small telescopes, plus in collaboration with smartphone astrophotography. So today, my talk focuses on this one. I will be touching on astrophotography utilizing the camera feature of mobile phones and how you can use them together with small telescopes. Perhaps a lot of you folks out there may think that bigger telescopes are always the best. Well, you shouldn't underestimate the power that small telescopes possess, and we will look into that right now. Okay, so regardless of the type of telescope, whether it be a refractor, a reflector, or a compound, and regardless of the quality, telescopes are broken into groups in terms of sizes. So telescopes with apertures of 4 inches and below are considered small telescopes. Second, telescopes with apertures above 4 inches but not exceeding 10 inches fall under the medium-sized telescopes. Those above 10 inches in diameter, but not exceeding 16 inches are considered large telescopes. And those above 16 inches, we classify them as very large telescopes. So today we are only going to zero in on small telescopes, as that is what my lecture is for the moment. Right. Perhaps many of you already have small telescopes or could be planning on buying one, well, going small has its advantages compared to the bigger ones. And I have enumerated a few. Number one, small telescopes tend to have wide field views. If you use a variety of eyepieces, you'd still get a wide view of where your telescope is pointed at. Number two, because it is a small telescope, it is light and easy to maneuver regardless of what kind of tripod it is mounted on. You can easily move it without tiring yourself, and even easy to put away after you're done using it. Number three, small telescopes can fit into luggages or backpacks. You can even bring a photo tripod instead of the heavy mount that sometimes come along with counterweights. Number four, small telescopes is likewise great for terrestrial viewing. You might have visited places where small telescopes are mounted on viewing decks, which enables you to see the breathtaking scenery up close. Okay, and then we have number five. Okay, this is vital for beginners, as there are a lot of newbies out there who had the thought of purchasing big telescopes and end up frustrated because of its complexity in operating. Therefore, my advice, and I'm sure my colleagues would agree as well, is that newbies should start with small telescopes, even binoculars, and enjoy what it can show you. Once you have gotten that hang of using it, then you can confidently convince yourself that you are ready to go on with the next level of upgrading to a more powerful telescope. And lastly, six, small telescopes are more affordable than the bigger ones. So start small and maximize the capability of using small telescopes. Binoculars are also good for beginners, and they likewise cost less. All right, so which brings us to our next question. What can be viewed through small telescopes? All right, so I've listed some of it. Okay, basically, what is listed here is what small telescopes can show you. So don't underestimate its power, because we have this ruling that it's not how far small telescopes can see, but how bright the object is that you're trying to view. For instance, the moon. If viewed from bigger telescopes, you could see it so close, but then you would want to see it as a whole. That's what small telescopes can do. So just a simple but critical reminder, though, viewing the sun requires using a solar filter. Never attempt on peeking through the telescope without these filters, as it will result in permanent damage and get you blinded. During the time of Galileo, the one who invented the telescope, or we could say the first one who used this to view the heavens, he started observing, he even observed the sun. Since solar filters were not yet invented, Galileo would observe the sun either during sunset or sunrise, and even made use of the presence of thin clouds when it is in front of the sun. And so that's how he was doing it, which was very risky. While it was said that Galileo had health issues concerning his eyesight, the way he was observing the sun, even without the aid of a telescope, contributed to the cause of his blindness. All right, so these are what I have experienced viewing through a small telescope. You can actually see the bright planets, excluding Uranus and Neptune, because they are quite far away. For the lunar eclipse, this is best, no? Observing the moon, lunar eclipse, star clusters, bright stars, bright nebulae, double stars, comets. Recently, we have viewed and even imaged comet E3, ZTF. Momentarily, I will show you a video of it. Okay, so there. So now we move on with some tips on what to prepare for when you're planning on stargazing. And I have listed here rather the important ones. First, you have to be clear of what you plan to observe or image as your starting point. Then come up with a checklist of what you need for your stargazing session, such as tents, reclining chair, your equipment for your imaging, those sort of stuff. Next is the telescope that you're planning to use. Align your finder scope with the main scope, practice on how to operate it if it is your first time using a telescope. A good practice is spotting distant objects during the daytime, such as hilltops and tall communication towers. This will help fine-tune your skills when pointing your telescope to planets, stars, and whatever is up there during the night. Patience is always a must. It may be a little difficult at first, so always start with a low-powered eyepiece to help you master your telescope. Another thing that is very important is checking the weather forecast for your chosen location. There are pretty good weather apps that can give you even 3 to 5 days of nearly accurate predictions, so you have enough time to make certain changes for your observing site. Next, know the background, your planned site, if it has obstructions around, which cardinal points are blocked, how high is the obstruction, also the amount of light pollution in the area. And of course, the accessibility of the site is vital because it'll give you the idea of what you need to only bring with you, depending on how easy or difficult it is to go there. Make sure to bring what is most essential that will make yourself comfortable during your stargazing night. All right, so we have tackled on with the basics of what we need to know about observing the night sky. You surely would want to do some astrophotography to complete our stargazing. Well, I could say that everyone nowadays owns a mobile phone, and it's really essential to our everyday activities. One feature that we always use is its camera. If your camera feature has pro settings, then congratulations. You would be able to do some astrophotography with it. So what can we photograph using the pro features of your camera? I've listed down what can be imaged. Constellations, Milky Way, meteors, bright comets, the moon, planets from a distance, sun and moon halos, and crepuscular rays. Well, actually, these are not astronomical. The last two parts, they're not beyond our atmosphere. Okay. So on the left side of the slide is a typical setup for your astrophotography. Imaging constellations or even meteor showers. This is the best setup for it. You simply have the photo tripod, the mobile phone, and the phone adapter that holds your phone and mounted on the tripod. I will provide you a bit more info on this in the next few slides. So if you're planning to shoot for bright stars or constellations, then set your ISO to 1000. Or higher. So this is just an example, a giveaway. Higher ISOs tend to capture fainter stars, so you get more stars in your image. The autofocus or AF must be set to infinity, as always, when you're shooting astronomically. And the shutter speed or exposure time can be set at 20 to 30 seconds. Okay. You can actually do several shots with different exposure times, and you're free to delete the bad ones. So practice a lot in order to get the best image that suits your taste. Oh, great. Now here is what you need for your mobile astrophotography: the tripod, the mobile phones, the telescope, phone holders. There are actually two types of phone holders. One is the one that you saw earlier, where you attach the phone directly to the tripod for taking imaging constellations. And the other one, the other holder, is what you use to attach the camera right in front of the eyepiece. Okay. Now, the adapter helps in preventing movement or vibrations when you tap the shutter button to take a shot of what is being viewed in the telescope. You may also try setting a timer so that once you tap on the shutter, which can result to vibration, the timer gives the phone enough time to stop shaking before the shot executes. And that is what, and this technique will give you a better image. Okay, so here's how it looks like when you attach your mobile phone to a telescope using the phone adapter you saw from the previous slide. This eliminates the difficulty of trying to hold your phone steady with your hands while taking a shot, which ends up blurry. The adapter helps in preventing movement or vibrations when you tap the shutter button to take a shot. Okay. Okay, there are a lot of mobile phones nowadays which have very good cameras for astrophotography, both for still shots and even time lapse. What is really important is that the phone must have the pro settings feature. Second is that the rear camera has high resolution in order to get really crispy shots. So I've listed the most common brands of phones that support pro features. I'm not sure if there are others out there, which I am not aware of. So just to give you a head start. All right, so here's a screenshot of the Huawei Nova 3i, which has pro settings. Once you tap that, the pro button, you will see the individual settings on the right, the ISO, the shutter speed or exposure time, the exposure value, the autofocus or AF, where you tap it to set it to manual focus. And that's when you slide the slider to infinity. Okay, so lastly, the auto white balance or AWB, but we will leave that thing as it is right now. Right, so now that we have tackled the info on small telescopes, what can be observed and doing mobile astrophotography with or without the telescope, I will now show you how I process a raw image of the moon, which I photographed from my 3-inch telescope via a smartphone. Then using an image processing app, in this scenario, I used Snapseed, which is my favorite since it is straightforward and very easy to use. So kindly sit back and watch how it's done. Okay. I'll be playing a video for you right now. Kindly enjoy. All right, so that's all, folks. Oops. Right, so that is the power of mobile astrophotography. So thank you very much, and I hope I hope I was able to inspire everyone to go into astrophotography using their mobile.
Thank you, Peter.
Thank you.
Can I share my screen?
Yep.
We have one question here, Peter, from your excellent presentation. It was very clear and I hope would inspire the watchers or viewers to use their phone more often. It's readily available and it's a very practical thing to do to learn astrophotography. So the question here is from Mr. Daniel Pantaleon. Good morning, Sir Peter. A common apprehension of first-time buyers for telescopes would be a telescope's price. Since we know astronomy tends to be an expensive hobby, what would be the usual price range of beginner telescope to set up, to set people's budget expectations? Yeah. I noticed you have a very cheap setup, yeah. So maybe you can mention that.
Well, there are a lot of ways where you can actually buy a purchase cheaper telescopes. One of them would be like cutting edge. Others. Well, there are other hobbyists who tend to sell their old telescopes, which are still in good condition. You can also opt for that. So that would actually depend on the seller. We also have online shopping, such as Lazada and Shopee. So the budget would, well, kind of range from like 10,000 up. Well, if you can budget up to like 20,000 pesos. Yeah, so I think that would actually give you a decent telescope to start with. Yeah. Well, nowadays, telescopes have been fluctuating up and down. So you can start searching online. 20,000 pesos budget would actually give you a good one.
Okay, Peter, a follow-up question there here is, what is the budget for telescope setup with cell phone adapter?
Well, you can't actually, you don't, well, I haven't found a way of, or a setup that includes everything in it. So, in my experience, I bought my my stuff separately. So the telescope or the phone holder, you can actually get it online in Lazada or Shopee. They sell like a few hundred pesos only. So
is this the one wherein you can put it on the camera on top of the eyepiece? Is that the one that
yes,
you're mentioning?
The one, uh-huh. Yes, the one that, so there are actually two phone holders. The first one is what you use to attach the camera, your phone camera, onto the in front of the eyepiece. So that is a different price. And the other one, which you also need to have with you, is the one that you attach to the tripod. So this is great for imaging constellations or even during a meteor shower. So you, with the pro settings itself, you open, you set the exposure time to like 30 seconds the most. So it will sit there and hope that the meteors would appear right in front of where your camera phone is pointed at.
Thank you, Peter. Here's another question, again, from Mr. Christian DiMacali of PAS. Mm-hmm. Number one, what is your favorite celestial body to photograph?
Saturn.
Like Saturn, because of the rings. Yes, yeah.
Because of the rings.
Like all of it. And number two, top three favorite astronomical events that you were able to observe either with naked eye or through a telescope. Well, I know one of them.
Yes.
Meteors. Yeah.
Yes. So meteor showers.
What is the top three?
The top three. So number one, meteor showers. So in one of my slides, you saw a shot there where I that was during the Perseids meteor shower. So it was a fireball that streaked right in front of where my camera phone was pointed at. Then second, the lunar eclipse. Yeah, it's very easy, but I love lunar eclipses. And the third one should be about comets. So the last two slides that you saw, the last two slides were from Comet E3 ZTF. So I placed the camera right in front of the eyepiece, a focal. And then of course, it's when you're beginning doing mobile mobile astrophotography, it's kind of difficult, but you just have to really have some patience to get the feel of how to set it up. So the reward is always perfect when you learn to exercise what you can do.
Peter, and there's a follow-up question here from Thomas Encarnacion. Aligning the phone camera to the eyepiece is really challenging. Do you have any tips on how to quickly align it to get good pictures of targets?
Okay, so the way I do it to align the camera phone to the eyepiece is that you have to put a flashlight right in front of the objective lens. So once you switch it on, so the light goes in there and then pops up into the eyepiece, and that's where you have to maneuver. The phone holder itself has locks where you can unlock it and then try to align the camera onto the eyepiece. You will get a very crisp field of view of the barrel of the eyepiece, and that's that is the mark that tells you that you are perfectly aligned with the eyepiece. So once you take take some test shots and try to view if number one, it is centered. Number two, if it is in focus. Okay, so there are a lot of tests that you have to do before you can perfectly get it to work.
A related question to that, Peter, is when taking the photos, is there a way of avoiding camera shake by touching the phone, like using the 2 second delay or even a remote?
Yes. Yes, there are remotes, Bluetooth remotes where you can purchase online as well. You can set that by Bluetooth on your phone, so you don't have to touch your camera, your phone itself. Secondly, if you don't have one, you can set the timer of your camera so that once you touch it, like the vibration is there, but if you set the timer to like 3 to 5 seconds, it will give the camera phone enough time to stop shaking. Okay, so that's when the timer of the shutter goes on after the timer, after the first timer that you have set.
And Peter, I notice you don't use a tracker, so it's okay that you don't use a tracker even for comets with cell phones?
That's a very good question, Doctor. So if your telescope happens does not come along with a tracker.
Yeah, most people only have tripods.
Right, you have to lower the exposure time so to avoid your image to trail. So in my images for Comet E3, once I have set the exposure time to like 8 seconds or more than that, you would start seeing trails in your images. So I try to step down to like 6 seconds. If the image still appears to have trails, I step it down to the next level until you get a decent shot where the trails would not appear.
Thank you. A follow-up question here from Daniel Pantaleon. What things do beginners need to watch out for when identifying cheap telescopes but of low quality? So what are the tips for identifying so that they don't have to waste their money on cheap telescopes, which is of low quality?
Well, the best advice I can give you is always consult an amateur astronomer. No matter how good the advertisement is, it is always best to coordinate with someone who has experience with telescopes.
And they can join ALP and consult us.
Exactly. If you have the link where you saw this telescope that you were planning to buy, you can send it to ALP, and we have astronomers who can help you out to give you the tips if the one that you're aiming for is good or not. Okay, so proper consultation is the best.
Thank you, Peter. And here's another one from Jamie Lynn De La Rosa. Do you have any recommended places within or near the metro to get nice mobile astrophotography shots?
Yes. One place should be like in Angono, Rizal. There is a hilltop right there where you can actually get clear shots of the night sky. That's one of the one of the places that is quite near to the metro, but is it's like a 1.5 hour drive from the city, from Quezon City. So we have other places like in Antipolo, also in, you can also travel up north. There are beach resorts that has good skies, such as in Bolinao. We were just there like 2 weeks ago in order to spot the Comet E3, because when you're in one of those resorts, the beachfront is actually facing north, so you don't actually have obstructions right in front of you. So that's when I was able to capture the comet during its closest approach to Earth. Okay, so there are a lot more. So if a few of our listeners have suggestions that they are aware of with regards to locations that they can recommend to our listeners, they can actually, they're always welcome to approach us and let us know if they would like to invite us to their areas, and we can check it out.
Thank you, Peter.
By the way, Peter, regarding yung question kanina na on where to get some good telescopes, no? Quality telescopes. I forgot to tell them that Cutting Edge is a Celestron distributor here in the Philippines, no?
Yes.
So they can offer you some better telescopes, no? With the Celestron brands. And one thing good about joining an organization like ALP, when you become a member, regular member, you'll get a 15% discount on buying a telescope.
Yes. So
Actually, that's one way of getting the telescope a little bit cheaper, no? But with quality.
Yeah.
Also, regarding yung size pa, yung areas of observation, some good sites na hindi naman sobrang malayo, no? Not too far away, like in Calamba Ecosal din Caliraya.
Yes,
as well as some good. Actually, there are a lot of good sites in Tanay, right? Also, aside from Angono. So these are close by and more accessible and less than the traffic travel. That's it.
Yes. Thank you very much. That's our president, James Kevin T. Yes. So thank you for adding, shedding light to the question earlier. Okay.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you so much.
Peter. I think, yes.
Well, you, I disappeared again. Okay.
You're good.
Very good.
Yeah. Peter, you said we helped you. Now you have to help me. Because I could not, I found out that my phone is capable of astrophotography. Mm-hmm. And I was very fascinated to find out that when we were shooting the comet during its closest approach, which was really pretty bad because the moon was very bright, but I discovered something. I handheld the phone, just shoot some constellation photos, and they came out very good. So I said, how did that happen? You know, I was hand-holding it, and the light of the moon was helping out. But I could not find the pro control for my phone, and I don't know how to choose which lens I'm going to use. Do I need an app for that? Did your phone came with it? Or
no, it's actually one of the features of your phone. So when... Yeah, it's one of the features of the phone, but I'm not familiar with an iPhone, so
okay.
Right. I'm sorry with that one. Yeah, maybe see some of our
see Peter, when we use our, I don't know if it's visible.
No, it's not visible. No, that's fine. Every phone now has three lenses.
Yeah, it has three lenses. It's hard to like that.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So it keeps on changing, it's like when you're doing
switching lenses.
When you're holding it up against an eyepiece, it changes.
Yeah, it's an iPhone.
Yeah. Ah, okay. Mm-hmm. But I haven't actually used one of those during astrophotography during my mobile.
But I like the one you have the pro controls. You can control the exposure, everything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Right. Thank you for that one. Maybe I could look into that one.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Thanks.
Well, Jeff, since we're still National Astronomy Week here, we forgot earlier to acknowledge June's wonderful contribution for getting the proclamation, the second proclamation from
President
Ramos.
Yeah.
You know, he continued what we did, and we are very appreciative of that. You know, all of us are working together as a team, you know, in
continuing
to promote astronomy to our kababayans. And now with the speaker series of the ALP, promoting Philippine astronomy to the world.
Yeah, it was June Lau who actually was instrumental in President Fidel Ramos' proclamation 130.
Yeah, because what we started
to continue your work. Yeah.
Yeah, what we started in 1990 and 92 with proclamation from President Corequino, those were one-time events. And June, that's Francisco
Lau Jr.
was able to convince President Ramos to come up with a proclamation declaring
every year
the third week of February of every year as National Astronomy Week. So we wouldn't be here without June's efforts. So thank you, June.
I think that what we need to do is like what you are doing now. You got to train people, the future generation, to continue that. You know, it's like, you know, astronomers from before, we are continuing their work and somebody needs to continue our work.
Yeah, what Phil Wyman and Father Bedelia started, we continued in the 1980s. So it's up to the new generation of amateur astronomers to continue what we're doing for the next decade.
And I'm very, very happy, by the way, to hear questions coming from people in the PAS. And our hope and our wish is that, you know, that everybody in whatever organization you belong, that we can all get together through astronomy, you know, support each other.
And it was also June Lau who created that video
Yeah, he's always very quiet, same as Peter.
Yeah, the video presentation at the beginning of the program, he was able to put that together, together with Casey.
Yeah, Casey T.
Yeah, Casey T. So thank you guys. Sorry, yeah. Peter, we digress.
So Peter.
Sorry, Peter, also, there was a question about small telescope, you know, what to buy and all that.
Yeah.
In our experience, we get to collect telescopes too, because, you know, every time, you know, you got to change, you want something bigger. But you started with a small telescope. We started with a small telescope too. And even up to now, you know, go for quality. If you cannot afford the big telescope right now, go for a small telescope, but good quality. Because if you decide later on to get a bigger one, you can keep that small telescope. Yes. And trust me, you know, there will be times when you want to just go out with your backpack, with your little telescope in your backpack.
Camping.
You know, especially like when you get to our age where, you know, Edwin would sometimes ask, did this get heavier? Or, you know, is it really just heavy because we were younger back then that we could easily lift something like that? But, I mean, in our explorer room, we call it our living room, I now have set up the little telescopes because I want to go back to using
them. Yeah, I think the cycle is when you're young and you're starting, you want bigger and bigger telescopes. And then when you reach a mature age, then you just go back to smaller and smaller telescopes. Yeah. But anyway, thank you, Peter. It was a very wonderful presentation.
Thank you, guys, for the compliment. Thank you, Peter. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Thanks. And we would like to award you your certificate. So,
wow, thank you.
Your ALP awards you the certificate of appreciation. The certificate is presented to Peter Tubalinal for his invaluable insights, experiences, and expertise shared with the participants for his talk, Observing the Sky with Small Telescopes, held as part of the ALP NAW 2023 opening program, given this 19th of February of 2023, signed by James Kevin T, President, and Jose Francisco Aguilar, Vice President. Thank you again, Peter.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Hope you will post this video in YouTube, make a tutorial.
Yes, I will.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Doc.
So before we conclude today's program, I would like to thank all our attendees for joining us. We will be sending you your certificates of attendance for today's webinar by email to all registrants who were able to join us today. We are grateful to all our speakers who very generously gave their precious time to share their knowledge and expertise to the world amateur astronomical community. We can never thank you enough. And I would like to make some announcements now. Last year, we had our ALP Astronomy Experts Speaker Series, and we had 10 successful talks by very, very prominent esteemed speakers. And we are continuing this 2023 with our Astronomy Experts Speaker Series. And for the past talks, you can actually view them in, as well as for this program, we will be posting this in our official Astronomical League of the Philippines YouTube channel, and we can access it here as shown below in the link below. So I would like to announce now that our next ALP Astronomy Experts Speaker Series for 2023. Will be given on March 12. That is a Sunday. That is a Sunday at 10 a.m. Philippine Standard Time. And this is 9 p.m. March 11, Saturday, Eastern Standard Time. And none other than by Professor Heidi B. Hamel, who is the Interdisciplinary scientist for the James Webb Space Telescope. And Dr. Hamel will talk about the latest discoveries of the James Webb Space Telescope in the field of planetary science, including the dust rings of Neptune and the new exoplanet HIP-65426b. So this will be a very interesting talk on the James Webb Space Telescope. And I'm sure everybody will be interested in this. Join us this March 12, Sunday. Registration is free, as usual, for this webinar. And we will be posting the announced registration page link later. And this will be followed on April 30, that is a Sunday, 9:30 a.m. Philippine Standard Time and 9:30 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, April 29, Saturday, for the talk, A Brief Tutorial on Comets by Daniel Green, the director of the IEU Central Bureau for Astronomical Telegrams, or CBAT. So Dr. Daniel Green will talk about what comets are, how they are becoming harder to define in terms of their physical nature, how they are discovered and named, some statistics regarding comets, and how amateur astronomers can contribute greatly to the science of comets. So this is another exciting talk on April 30. And on May 20, Dr. Debra Imelgreen, who will be joining us again. Thank you again, Debra, for joining us today. And Debra will talk on the topic, A Glimpse of Galaxies at the Dawn of the Universe. So this will be on May 20, Saturday, 8:30 p.m. Philippine Standard Time and 8:30 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time. So look for the links that we will be posting in our social media page and also at the webpage of the Astronomical League of the Philippines. James, do you have an announcement for our activity this afternoon?
Yes, I'll share the screen. Wait. By the way, to celebrate, in celebration of National Astronomy Week, we offer 2 free star telescope viewing session, which is later today, February 19. We will have a solar viewing if the weather is okay, from 3:30 to around 5 p.m. No? So you will be able to look at the sun through white light, hydrogen alpha views. No? Then afterwards, around 6 to 9 o'clock, we will be providing a free telescope viewing of planet Jupiter, Venus, Orion, and several bright objects. No? But these are what we call weather dependent. No? So right now, actually, the weather is not that good. No? So nevertheless, we're still keeping our fingers crossed. No? So if the weather will be okay, no? But in case we miss this tonight, this afternoon, we also have another one on February 25 from 7 to 9:30 p.m., no? By the way, both of these events will be held in SM by the Bay near the fountain area, no? In SM Mall of Asia. So join us, no, and get an experience of your lifetime to get a true view of the celestial objects through our telescopes. Thank you.
And this will be our first stargazing after the pandemic.
Yes. Stargazing. Yes. Very true. Very true. And hopefully this will start the our regular free telescope viewing
normalization. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, James. Can I share my screen again? Sorry. So that's it. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone, for attending. I would like to end now our program. And please, for all the panelists, we will just have a very short post-webinar meeting. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye, guys. Thank you.
Bye, guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye.